This is the end. The end of Jesus' earthly life. And we get to experience in Scripture today the fulcrum on which history turns. You know what a fulcrum is? If you have a lever, the point at which you lever the lever, that's the fulcrum. And all of history turns at this very moment. And so as we see all the events leading up to Jesus' last breath, we see all creation with bated breath. Jesus, the Son of God, sent by God, the babe in the manger, rejoiced over by angels, who was baptized by John, who preached, who healed, who raised the dead, confounded the religious leaders, gathered his disciples, taught in parables, and finally was betrayed, falsely condemned, and crucified. And here we meet the way, the truth, and the life facing death on the cross. His back beaten from the scourge, his head bleeding from the crown of thorns, his hands and feet screaming with pain by the spikes driven through them. God in the place of the lowest brigand, hanging between two robbers as those all around mocked him. All who see me mock me. They make mouths at me. They wag their heads. His enemies celebrated. But then, as the sun rose high over the crucifixion, it came directly overhead. It was the sixth hour, noon. And at that moment, the sun went dark. Now, this was no natural eclipse. It being the Passover, was a full moon. But the sun didn't care what was natural, but dimmed. And it was the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour, which would be about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Creation, which began in darkness when God said, "Let there be light," is now dark again, as if there is a reset about to happen. The one whom created all things was about to die. Now, this is, when it goes dark, a specific fulfillment of prophecy. And on that day, Amos 8:9, "And on that day, declares the Lord God, I will make the sun go down at noon," the sixth hour, "and darken the earth in broad daylight. I will turn your feasts into mourning and all your songs into lamentation." We'll see the mourning of the crowds in a bit. Darkness is a heavenly portent again and again. The sign of the day of the Lord in Joel and Ezekiel, Zephaniah 1, Psalm 107. And you got to wonder, as Jesus is being crucified, saying, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what to do." And even yet, as the scribes and the Pharisees see the sun go dark, why do they not repent at this moment? How could they not see the dark turn of events? But still today, there are so many warnings. You know, every time there is suffering in this world, every earthquake, every tragedy is a warning to turn to God before it's too late, and yet many ignore the warning. Now, the darkness that descended on the land is a nod to a specific point in Israel's history, an important point. So we go back, we think of the Exodus, where the 10 plagues of Egypt, you go through and they start getting worse and worse. And the ninth plague was darkness, not for 3 hours, but 3 days. The Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand toward heaven that there may be darkness over the land of Egypt, a darkness to be felt." Gotta love the writing there. That's just great. So Moses stretched out his hand toward heaven, and there was pitch darkness in all the land of Egypt 3 days. of this specific judgment which fell on the land of Egypt was for their unbelief, their refusal to turn and believe in the power of the Lord God. And again here, over the land of Israel now, comes the judgment of darkness falling on the land. And if you remember in the 10 plagues, darkness was the ninth plague, which led its way to the 10th plague, which would be the death of the firstborn son. A death only to be averted by those who would take the blood of the lamb and put it on their doorposts so the avenging angel of death would pass over. And now we see the exact same pattern again. The pattern that of Exodus, which points forward to this moment at which the fulcrum of history would turn, in which the darkness of the sign of God's judgment would give way to the death of the firstborn son. Except the avenging angel would not pass over, for God himself, Jesus Christ, would suffer to go to death in the place of his people, so that for any of us who believe in him might put his blood over the doorpost of our heart, that the avenging angel would pass over and we could be brought near to God, our Father. Everyone who rejects Jesus is in the darkness of sin and death. They are under the judgment of God, but they are so close to redemption. All you need to do is draw near to Jesus Christ, and you can be delivered from the darkness of ignorance to come close to God, because Jesus himself is the Lamb of God who is slain for the sins of the world. Jesus delivers from darkness. The people who've walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. In our darkness, Jesus has shone, dying on the cross. And if you follow the chain of events from darkness to the death of the firstborn, the next thing is deliverance from slavery. In the same way, those who trust in Jesus Christ can go from darkness to trusting in the death of the Son to the freedom of the wilderness, still waiting to pass over into the promised land. Now, this is the first thing that happens, is darkness falls over the land. But there's another moment, and it probably happens right about when Jesus dies, right towards the end of the darkness. And Luke puts them together here, Luke 23:45. While the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Now, all these events are kind of happening concurrently, and then it's going to go right to the end. But we see this event here, the curtain of the temple. If we think about the temple is this whole lesson for all of us in cosmetology and in our distance from God, because we have the unclean people way out here, and then if you get closer, you have sacrifices. If you get even closer, you get to where the priests can go into the first place where the altar of incense is, and the showbread inside the temple. But then even further, there's a place called the Holy of Holies, which has the Ark of the Covenant and the cherubim, and it's completely dark inside of here. This is doors inside of doors. And into this holy place, which represents God on earth, the high priest can only come once a year taking blood into this place. And in between the most holy place and the holy place is a curtain. And as Jesus died, this curtain was torn from top to bottom, letting the light in, taking away the distance between God and man. And I think there's five reasons the curtain tore. There's probably more, but These are the five important ones. And I think first of all, as the curtain tears, we see this is like the darkness was judgment. This was judgment on the temple. Jesus condemned the leaders and said, "My house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations, but you have made it a den of robbers." The tearing of the veil was God declaring that this temple was no longer worthy of his presence. Secondly, we see that the temple, that the curtain being torn, is the end of sacrifice. Because now these things, all of the sacrifices were pointing to the Son of God who would come to be the true sacrifice, that this was now done away with and not necessary. For we see, book of Hebrews, "For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins," that the power of the temple was always in Jesus Christ dying on the cross for the sins of the world. And now that that is accomplished, the thing that pointed to it was no longer necessary. So God tore the veil. Then this time of animal sacrifice is over. And so we can turn directly to the cross of Golgotha and no longer the altar of the temple. Third, I think, we see the curtain tearing out of God's sadness. Like this represented the presence of God on earth. You see, when people got bad news, when Job hears the news of his sons and daughters dying, he tears his robe. And so as the Son of God dies on the cross, willingly gives his life, God watching from heaven, as it tears his robe of the curtain of the temple in mourning for this event that he planned. Fourth, the tearing of the curtain shows that Jesus opens the door to paradise. Remember his words to the thief on the cross. "Today, you will be with me in paradise." The doors that were shut because of the distance between sinful man and God are now opened to let us go to the Father, so that Jesus died, and so no longer this distance between sinful man and God was bridged, so that us still today, that when we turn to Jesus Christ and say, "I believe in you," that we are connected to Jesus' death in such a way that his death pays the penalty for our sins. So we are no longer sinners, but righteous in the eyes of God. So we can go boldly into the holy place, boldly to God himself, to draw near to him, to be close to him, and have our lives changed by him. And we don't have to just get barely saved. Sometimes I feel like I get saved kind of by the skin of my teeth. I mean, it's like barely, like I'm like I like graduated last in the Christian class. No, but fully given the righteousness of God so that I can draw near to God as the Son draws near to the Father. And fifth, the curtain of the temple tears because God comes out to his people. No longer would God be defined by a people and a place, the Jewish people, the place being Jerusalem, but God would go to every corner of the earth, from the lowest valley in California to the highest mountain in Nepal, would the presence of God dwell. And we see the fulfillment of this in Acts 2, when there came from heaven a sound like mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting, and divided tongues as a fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. God was with his people, so that everywhere where we call upon Jesus in the name of the Father, we can worship him in spirit and truth, not in a place or a temple, but by the Holy Spirit dwelling in us. when we turn to him. Now, after these things, Jesus, calling out with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. It literally says he breathed out. And it was over. And as he breathes out, he is offered in the place of his people to God, an acceptable sacrifice, paying the penalty for every sin that his people have committed and will commit, which God accepts, and we know this by his resurrection. His cry here is actually a quote from Psalm 31, which is a psalm that many Jewish people still use today as kind of a bedtime prayer. It's a psalm of trust that God will be with him. And even at this moment, we sing, when he says to the Father, turns his face away, the sky goes dark. Even in this moment, Jesus trusts in the power of God right to the end to deliver him from death. For it says, verse 17 of Psalm 31, "O Lord, let me not be put to shame, for I call upon you. Let the wicked be put to shame. But into your hand I commit my spirit. For you have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God." God hears Jesus' prayer and receives Christ's spirit until the time of resurrection. Jesus breathes his last. And as we saw all the way back in creation, when God said, "Let there be light," when God breathed into Adam the breath of life, here we have life himself breathing out the breath of life, and so winning all of Adam's race. The death purchased us, paid for our sin, his blood spilled, his life for our lives, all accomplished. Was witnessed by the centurion. Now the centurion, when he had taken place, he praised God, saying, "Certainly this man was innocent," or just or righteous. The centurion, a Gentile, recognizes what God has done. And the crowds who had come to jeer mourn, as Amos foretold. And all the crowds that assembled for the spectacle, when they saw what had taken place, they returned home, beating their breasts. And all his acquaintances and the women who had followed him from Galilee stood at a distance, watching these things. And they came, but they stood far off, helping us to see that Jesus was alone in this moment, and yet trusts in God's power. So, what did we learn here? We're going to learn here, and then we're going to respond. Learn is that the darkness was judgment that ultimately leads to freedom, like in Exodus. See, the temple sacrifices are ended with the one sacrifice of Christ. The curtain was torn so that you and I could enter paradise. And God comes out to dwell with his people. We want to see first, we understand, like, this happened. We say, this is how Jesus died, and stand back in awe. Secondly, like, we want to just glorify God. Like, thank you, God, for this gift. Thank you, Jesus Christ, for going to the end to die for his people. And finally, all of us, trust in Jesus' power for salvation. His death is the only way that you and I have any hope in this life at all. Any hope. And he went all the way to the end so that we, believing in him, could have eternal life. He breathed his last so we could be with God forever. Let's pray. Oh Lord God, I pray that each one of us would see you today, that you died on that cross to pay for our sin, that you paid the penalty in full so that we could have eternal life. I pray that every person here would receive you, honor you anew, glorify your name. Oh, what a salvation that Jesus Christ came to die for me. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.